the current political situation, I think it's sort of like the worst of times and the best of times, right?
So Dan Jacobson is the legislative director of Environment California, which means he hangs out in Sacramento and lobbies, among other things, I'm sure. But the lobbying, I just want to say that in 2016, when we were working on the passage of SB 32, and it was like the last minute of the last hour, and we didn't know if we were going to live or die, and we didn't know what to do, and we didn't know what was happening in the legislature, somebody would talk to Dan, and he would tell us the latest information, and what was going to work, and what we should be doing, and it was like, it was just a lifeline. He is a lifeline for us as an environmental lobbyist, and so we're so grateful that he can be here to talk to us about, we've had some questions about this. Where do we go from here? What's going to happen with cap and trade? There is a lawsuit, there's problems at the legislature. Could we have a carbon tax? Could we even pass it? What's going to happen with renewables? What's the future, especially given this recent election? So take it away, Dan.
I guess maybe I'll start off by saying I try to live in the world of under-promise and over-deliver, and that you've just sort of set me up to fail in that world. I guess what I want to do is, maybe I'll just try to talk about a couple of different things. It's kind of hard to talk about it. I kept rereading, hoping that the words would change when Jack sent me the things that talk about the future. And I kept hoping, if I look at it, and I'm slightly dyslexic, so I thought maybe it'll say something else when I read it next time. But they kept saying the same thing, and so I kept thinking, I really don't know. And then I came here early thinking, oh, well, I'll listen to all these other really, really smart people, which is what I try to spend most of my time doing, and then they'll tell me the answer. But as you heard, many of them said, oh, we don't know, and it's really hard to predict. So then I thought, well, that's not helping me at all, and that became kind of frustrating too. But I thought we'd break this up into maybe just two different sections. I'll try to talk a little bit about what I think the political situation in Sacramento is right now. I'll try to spend a little bit of time what I think are opportunities that we might have. But then I've been up in Sacramento for 16 or 17 years as a lobbyist, but before that I spent about 10 or 12 years just doing organizing, so citizen organizing, a lot of student organizing, just like you guys are doing. So I thought maybe just talk about organizing, and if you guys have questions, like you go, oh, well, we want to do this bill, could we get this one through? And I will give you my best lay of odds of what I think the chances of that going through are going to be. So let's do that, and then we'll kind of maybe have a little bit more time for questions as we sort of break it up, and we'll bring other people up here and try to do sort of a closing round on that. Think of this as the encore act. So you've had a great first set, you've had a great second set, and then we'll do a little encore here, and then we'll be able to head out of here. So the current political situation, I think it's sort of like the worst of times and the best of times, right? So if you just look at the federal stuff, and I don't want to spend a lot of time talking about that, but you're like, oh, that's the worst of times that we're going to have. And that'll impact California and a lot of the programs that we've put into place. So whether it's the Clean Power Plan that everybody's talked about before and people are pretty familiar with, whether it's fuel economy standards, whether it's energy efficiency standards, there's a bunch of things that the federal government controls. We don't know. He has said Clean Power Plan is going to be off the table on day one, but there are a lot of other things we don't know, and we'll obviously work as hard as we can at the federal level to try to convince him and the folks that he appoints that this is going to move us in the right direction. I actually think there's some room for optimism there. On other issues, I think we're in really big trouble, but I think on some of these issues, there's a little bit of room for optimism. I think if you look at the state of California, you sort of go, well, we're actually in as good a political situation as I think as we're going to get. We could have a lot of back and forth about the governor, and when we were talking about fracking, I thought you were going to call me up because I've been kicked out of the governor's office more times than I can remember talking to them about fracking, and that's fine, you know, and that's what it is. But he's still, when it comes to the stuff that you were talking about, probably no one better. When he's looking at the amount of GHGs that the state of California is producing and the plan that we have for getting that down, there's certainly no other governor and the governor of the 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th largest economy in the world doing the stuff that he's doing, he is doing a really good job at doing exactly that. The Senate President, Senator De Leon, is again, I think, one of the best people that we could put into power at this time to be doing exactly what he's doing. Now, is he a physicist or is he a nuclear expert on any of this stuff? No, he'll tell you the first, I think he'd be the first person to tell you he's not an expert on this stuff. He actually comes from community organizing, from the labor union. That's where he sort of cut his teeth. He's from a fairly disadvantaged community down in San Diego, and that's where he sort of is personally impacted by this stuff. And that's where I think there's a much larger crossover between climate and environmental justice than we've ever seen before. It's him. The Speaker of the California State Assembly, Anthony Rendon, comes from a similar background. He spent a lot of time being the interim executive director of the California League of Conservation Voters. So he has access to some of the best environmental lobbyists up in California and consults with them on a regular basis and some of the smartest people in the state on this stuff. So if you have those two guys in the Senate and in the Assembly, and you've got a governor who, like I said, you might have disagreements with him, and I certainly do on fracking, but on all these other things, you sort of go, we're in a pretty good spot. And at the local level, if you look at some of the mayors that we have here, so if you look at, you know, Oakland, San Francisco, LA, San Diego, with a Republican mayor, has pledged to go 100% carbon free by, I think, either 2035 or 2040. California is peppered. The mayor of Lancaster, a Republican mayor, again, has looked at the situation and said, all new homes that we build in that city have to have solar on them, are going to be net zero energy buildings. So if you think then, well, what's the, look, there's a dark cloud over the eastern central part of the country. But then if you looked and kind of looked, oh, as you go further west, the light continues to shine and shines pretty brightly on the powerful policies that we can pass here in California. So that's what I mean. Now, again, people sort of poo-pooed the Democratic majority or the supermajority and said, well, yeah, it's not going to really help. You know what it gives is more people to go lobby is one thing, and that makes it a little easier. So from my perspective of, like, at least being able to walk in the door and kind of have an argument or a discussion about some of these issues, that's a little bit better. But, you know, don't dismiss the power that the pro tem and that the speaker have. They usually have three or four times every session where they just say, we don't care about your problem, you're lining up on this issue with us. Now, our job will be to make climate one of those issues that they have to line up on, if it even comes to that, and hopefully it doesn't. But I think a bigger part of our role, and the role that you guys all play as organizers, is never getting us to the point where we need the 41st vote. If we're doing our job in the communities, we should have 47, 48 votes in the Assembly on a regular basis. We should have 22, 23 votes in the Senate. Things should be fairly cleared for us. And in California, of all places, even though I know we are the third largest oil-producing state in the country, and a lot of the refineries that we have and a lot of the, you know, that does bring a lot of that tension, this is a better place for us to be organizing and pushing the envelope on that stuff. So when you call and say, oh, what do? I think you're really frustrated, as I've always got the sense, because my answer is, well, go back out into the community and get more phone calls in, because they slammed the door on me so many times that I can't even walk into that particular office anymore. So until you get that leverage that I need, it doesn't do me any good. And the facts are incredibly important to have, and we need the really smart people in the room to be able to present those facts. But if you think that facts win votes, like I said, they're important to have, and you sort of need to be able to say, no, this is right, and look, I can prove to you that it's right, and I've got all these really smart people that will stand with me and tell you that this is right. But if you're trying to win a vote, put it on the table, a moderate Democrat from any part of the state of California, those facts aren't going to do it. They have to feel like people in their communities are engaged in this issue and are talking about it. And we can talk about this a little more if you want, but that's why so much of the cap and trade stuff has become such a political hot potato, because now many people are sort of looking at that pot of money, billions of dollars, and going, oh yeah, if that's what it takes, spend that money here, and all of a sudden I'm in favor of the program. A lot of people have talked about that today. That's not really the best way to solve the climate crisis that we're dealing with. And we don't want to look back after 10 years of cap and trade programs and having raised tens of billions of dollars and put in systems that don't solve our particular problem. Cap and trade, if we're going to stick with that system, should be used to help solve the worst impacts of climate. People are looking at it also as a way to help equal off some of the constant environmental injustices that we've had throughout the state of California. But we're going to have to figure out how to do that. Let me talk a little bit about some of the four or five things that I think you'll be hearing from the legislature. And I'll put it out right now. I think the legislature is going to be pretty aggressive at passing climate legislation this year. I think if you listen to what the pro tem and the speaker and the governor are talking, they have made a lot of statements about this. But their staff, everyone is sort of gearing up. This is going to be a big 2 to 4 years for California on climate. We're going to have to make sure that we get it right and we continue to get it right. But my guess is they're going to want to go pretty hard, push the envelope, and not just sort of how we compare to other states around the country. But I think they're going to see this view of California as a world leader on climate and just adopt that and go as far and as fast as they can. Here's my guess as to the five things that they'll do. We'll see a lot more bills that will be introduced that'll deal with these things, and I'll get with the four or five issues that I think they'll deal with. We're going to see more money spent, so whether that's cap and trade money or other places from the budget that'll be used for this. The governor, I think, has been doing a tremendous job at seeking out, and so has the pro tem. I think he's been getting into this play a little bit, seeking out agreements with other states and with other countries. So the pro tem was just in, I think he went back to Mexico again, but he's been going back and forth there to try to see how he can help to make deals. The governor and his, I think, Keep It Under 2 program that some of you are probably pretty familiar with, continues to get more and more states and provinces and countries around the world to sign on to that. I think, especially with what Trump wants to do with the Paris Agreement, that'll become a bigger and more important piece. I think there's just statements that we want our elected officials making very strong statements on climate and talking about that. And the fifth thing is I want them engaging in fights, so I don't want them to back away from things. There's a lot of tension on how that's going to play. What will Trump withhold from the state of California? How far can they push on certain things? But, I want to see them get involved in that. That's why I think that if you're sitting in this room right now, this is probably one of the best times to be involved in climate issues and in climate legislation or the climate fight, and that California is one of the probably the best place to do it. I'd say there are three or four kind of key things that we need to focus on if we want to make sure that when these climate bills come up, I'm not desperately trying to get to that 41st vote or that 21st vote. I say me like it's me, but there's really much smarter and better lobbyists up in the Capitol. But the first thing that we'll need, more grassroots and more grass tops. So the petitions are good, but the more that we have the mayors or the city councils passing rezos, instructing their elected officials to move in a certain direction, that's been more helpful. We need more coalition building. I think it's time for us to reach out to the California Teachers Association and talk about how much money we could save if we put solar on all the schools and how that could be used to increase teacher salary or whatever different political programs that you want to put together. That might not be the smartest economic thing, so let me just preface that. But in politics, sometimes those two don't necessarily mix, but trying to figure out other ways to create self-interest for stronger political players in the state, and then we need to get more media on a lot of the work that we're doing as well. And I think that we'll have the opportunity to do that. Where are the bills going to come from and sort of what kind of bills, and then we can stop there and then maybe open it up to questions, and like I said, maybe try to bring everybody up and we'll do sort of a end of the program there. I think you'll see some bills talking about electricity, so people know that we have that SB 350 said that we'll get to 50% of our electricity from clean energy sources by 2030. We helped pass the first bill to get to 17% when Governor Davis was there. It was originally 20%, but his office made us kick it down to 17%, so then we've had to fight. And so to get to 50%, I thought was incredible. Just to put a little context, 50% of California's energy is like the 14 smallest states in the country getting 100% of their energy from clean energy sources. So when people sort of go, oh, that seems impossible, not only is it possible, but if you just put it in that context, I think it's really important to be able to see. I think we're going to see bills introduced, especially which come out of the ARB yesterday on their scoping plan or their new draft of a scoping plan of should we get to 60% and should we just not go to 100%. And we'll look at that. I think there's going to be a lot more seen on transportation and our ability to increase the number of access to public transit. One of the biggest issues that there is what's called first mile, last mile, the opportunity for people to actually get to the public transit systems that they need. And can we use clean vehicles to be able to do that? That'll be one. More clean cars. That'll be another one. We've worked with CBE on a program called Charge Ahead, which creates rebates that people talked about earlier today, where people in some of the most air polluted parts of the country can pick up electric vehicles at a significantly reduced rate. That's helping to drive that. And just like we did with solar panels in 2006, 2007, where we put a rebate for people who bought solar panels, you know, over 10 years, the California Solar Initiative, as that rebate, or as the time went down, the rebate went away, but the prices of solar, that's not the only reason, but I would think would be one of the reasons that the price of solar has come down. Can we do the same thing with electric vehicles, and whether it's cars, buses, trucks, and I think we'll see more on that. The third thing that we'll see, I think, is more bills and programs that deal with waste. Waste is another one of the places where we can offset, especially for the methane that the state is generating. And whether that's waste from oil drilling, whether it's waste from farms and ag, or whether it's waste from our own waste that we create, there's going to be different ways that we'll be able to reduce global warming pollutant. How do we use natural lands and farmlands? This, I think a lot of you in the room probably see this as the new carbon sink. This is one of those things where people go, oh, well, we have all this carbon in the air. This stuff actually draws it out of the air and puts it back into the ground. So there's a lot of excitement in thinking about that. I think we're going to see a lot of legislation that deals with fracking and with oil refineries. We'll continue to have disagreements with others on that issue. I don't mean between us, but I mean like us and the oil companies kind of thing. And that's where that's going to be a pretty big fight. But I think fracking, you're going to see it'll mostly be over the, again, I'm pretty sure people in this room have heard of it, but the wastewater and the crop irrigation, sort of those two things, and people are going, oh, that's kind of gross, and, you know, we can't do that. I think the more that Trump opens up and sort of goes, coast of California, open to more drilling, federal lands, open to more drilling, that the state will have sort of a reaction to that and kind of go, well, wait, no, we can't do that, and we've got to try to figure out ways to reduce that. And then the refinery stuff that Roger and other people talked about, I think we'll see legislation coming up on that. And then the final thing that I think we'll see legislation is, I just called it the Janet bill, because she was the leader of SB 185, which for the first time got CalPERS and CalSTRS to divest from coal companies. So thank you for the work that you did on that, Janet. I don't know if you know Janet, but and his staff, and then she's not satisfied with that and is now coming back with a second bill this year to continue to push the envelope on some of the fiduciary responsibilities that our big investment groups have in the state of California. So let's just end there, and then maybe we'll just have everybody come up and take, and we'll do questions, and we'll kind of do this as the swan song. So thank you all very much for having me.
Just, there are a couple of questions which are pretty much in your bailiwick, I think, Dan. So one is, can California itself enforce the EPA 54.5 miles per gallon rule without new legislation? This is something that may go away.
We obviously can't do anything at the federal level. Our state laws here are going to stay unless they get repealed. So California's got the rule. So do 19 other states. I don't know if they got repealed when Obama did that. I think if they did, then California will come back and just go, oh, well, we're going to do it again. So I have to check on that. I should know that. I'm embarrassed. I don't know if you know, Roger, if anybody else knows, Dr. Dean, the answer to that. But I think that my guess would be they don't. And that if they do, California pass them right again. And here's the other thing I would say about in 2008, when we were coming off the Bush administration, a bunch of us were going to Copenhagen to see if we could get a national agreement signed. We wrote a paper called, I think it's like the Path to Copenhagen or some uninventive name like that. But it was, what we basically looked at is we said, even though we had a horrible federal administration, if you actually look at what the individual states have done on climate and add all of that up together, we were massive players at the international community. And what we didn't want is for the international community to go, oh, well, your president has his head in the sand on climate, so we're all going to walk away from climate. And we wanted the argument to go, if you actually look at the individual states, the 50 individual states, and we looked at all 50 of them, and you might say, oh, well, did that work? Yeah, and of course, California was a leader, Massachusetts, New York, those were all leaders. But all 50 states have some kind of a program where they're working to reduce carbon, whether it's energy efficiency, whether it's insulation on homes, whether it's conservation programs, whether it's clean car programs, whether it's renewable portfolio standards. They all have that. And I think that's one of the biggest differences between now and 8-10 years ago, is that if you look at not just here in California, but around the country of who's helping to solve the climate issues. When we first passed AB 32, there were a lot of enviros in the room. There were a couple of folks, I mean, Environmental Justice was there, and it was still young, but it was mostly enviros. And I think we had one, you know, we were trying to find like the business community, and there was one dance studio that was supporting us. So they're like, oh, it's business. You're allowed to use anything, you know what I mean? I was like, I don't care, it's a business. And then if you look at like how we passed SB 32 last year, SB 32 was a bill that was basically passed by APEN and the California Environmental Justice Alliance. And lining up to that, you would go, businesses. We had some of the biggest businesses in the state of California coming and saying, we support this bill. Mm-hmm. We had some of California's top military brass coming up and saying, we support this bill. We obviously had businesses. We obviously had a ton of labor support. The Pope's thing was critical, you know, to getting all that stuff through. And if you look at what a difference the 10 years has made. So let's not fear too much of what, let's be afraid of what's happening on the East Coast, but let's not deer in the headlight us. Let's continue to do the kind of organizing and the outreach that we can, because the states can make the difference, and in California, that's why I think it's going to be hard to roll a lot of this stuff back, because so many businesses are now engaged in this, are moving forward with it. It's not like it is in other places.
Right, and the car manufacturers would not like to have to produce one kind of car for California and another kind of car for the rest of the...
It's what gives us the advantage on the energy efficiency standards, and that's why we always push it here, because we say, well, you know, you're like, oh, well, my TV here, it's the exact same as the TV you buy in Oklahoma, but I use less electricity to do it. At some point, everyone wants to get in on that, both the manufacturers and the consumer.
Okay. A couple more specifically for you. Just to take it back to cap and trade for a minute, it's possible that cap and trade is going to be, there's a lawsuit against it, and it's possible it will actually be decided that it's illegal, that we can't go forward. What do you think is going to, if that happens, is there the possibility of passing it, creating it again, or would we, is there the possibility of a different kind of carbon tax mechanism passing the legislature? What are the reality, the possibilities there?
I don't know. Mostly I don't know, because anybody who's a predictor is a really bad predictor, for the most part, I think. I'll tell you this, is I think the will is there to move forward on climate. If the courts come back and say, we're going to strike this particular provision down, I think that the governor, and this is partly what the doctor was talking about, you don't want to see California coming out with this thing that court strike, I mean, if the headline on the first day is court strike this down, the headline on the second day will governor signs second bill. it'll happen fairly quickly. I think the legislature is teed up with push, and the governor is sort of ready to do it. Will everything line up perfectly? That's impossible to predict, but I don't think the governor and the pro tem and the speaker want to go like, oh yeah, we lost in the courts, now let's deal with something else. I think if that happens, they're going to come back pretty strong, and I think that they might say, oh, now we're going to come back a little strong. And so, you know, don't doubt that that'll happen. It's going to be, again, it'll be hard. And again, supermajorities are hard because of what someone brought up. Moderate Democrats usually increase, not like the left increases. The way that the way the political map looks, it's more the moderates gain more power, not the left.
Okay. Most of the swing votes you were just talking about are outside the Bay Area. I mean, we did lobby Catherine Baker, and she was the only Republican to vote for SB
52. Another bipartisan bill. Yeah.
That's right.
That's like 1832.
That's right. But most of them are not in the Bay Area. So how can Bay Area activists support the, what can we do about those votes in the other parts of the state?
Travel is not that far to get to Fresno. Probably most of you went to Nevada to work on this last election. So I
so
think
actually go and work, huh?
I just think, you know, it's a lot of it, it's coalition building. I think, you know, politics is still about relationships, and grassroots power, I think, is still about people going and having discussions with other people about issues that they're concerned about, and that's what usually wins the day. And, you know, if we're really concerned about this stuff here in California, or in sort of one part of California, people all up and down the state are concerned. I mean, if you just look at the polling numbers and go, oh, well, how many people are concerned about air pollution, or how many people are concerned about water pollution, or how many people are even concerned about climate, the numbers are very high. The political work that we have to do is not as hard, I think, as people sort of go, oh, that would be impossible. If every one of you got, you know, 10 people to start to do some kind of outreach into the Central Valley, we'd probably be flipping seats and moving votes faster than you could imagine. So that does, you know, when you put it down like that, you go, oh, well, that's probably not that hard. And a lot of you would become a lot more moderate, because once you got there and had these conversations with people, they would say something and go, oh, yeah, well, I'll agree with that if you agree on, you know. So don't lose that, but still go fight.
Okay. I actually have a question up here for Severin, if he's wouldn't mind. Said you, Severin, said California can help with technology development aimed at the developing countries, but isn't it too expensive for them? And what can we do about the fact that it's, how can we make it more affordable and at the scale and speed that we need?
It is too expensive for them, and that's why they're continuing to build coal plants. And I think that's why California has to invest in these technologies to drive the cost down. And if you look at the progress in solar over the last 6-7 years and wind over the last 6-7 years, it's great. I just think California's greenhouse gas policy should be focused on, is this pushing forward technology that is going to come down in costs, or could potentially, obviously there are going to be failures, you're not investing in nothing if there aren't failures, but could come down in cost enough to be economic in the developing world. And frankly, I do not think rooftop solar, I think that puts rooftop solar at the end of the queue. I think there are many new technologies that have the potential. Most of them are grid-connected technologies, or at least microgrid-connected technologies. And we have to be very careful of investing in things that sort of help us meet a goal, but really aren't pushing the technology ball forward. But it is more expensive. Well, I think grid solar is a great example. It has come down from
What do you mean by grid solar again?
Grid scale solar, the solar farms, which solar farms can now produce electricity without subsidy at probably somewhere in the 7 to 8 cents a kilowatt hour levelized cost, whereas rooftop solar is closer to, it's more than double that. And so we really need to be thinking about those numbers, because we have to get technologies that when you bring them to India, when you bring them to Pakistan, to Bangladesh, to China, and say, here's a technology that at least can come close, that's when we start to really change the direction and bend the curve on world greenhouse gas emissions. And it just worries me that we're so focused on getting California to meet a specific numerical goal, which I think is not where we should be.
Thank you. We did get a question. I think it's been addressed to some extent, but we got a question about what is the possibility, or this is mainly for Dan, of a fee and dividend carbon tax kind of program in California.
I don't know. I mean, I feel like I say that for every question. I don't know. I mean, all that is going to depend on some of the things that happen both in Washington is going to be some of the stuff that happens with that lawsuit that we're talking about. And then that will influence more, I think, how the governor and the legislature will want to shift around on some of those policy questions. But, you know, it's possible. I think, you know, there are a lot of the charts here and the people talk about it is cap and trade the only way to get to, you know, the concept, whether it's the exact number that we need or to be able to bring our, you know, specific numbers down. And I think there's, clearly there's a debate on it because you've heard it from some of the smartest people in the state talking about it. So it's hard to say how that will happen politically. I think that's also something to think about politically. If you think we had really smart people here, even they were sort of like, well, we don't really know. Add politics into that? I mean, come on. No way can you predict that.
All right. We pretty much, I think, finished the card questions, or a lot of them. Are there any audience questions? We can hand you the mic. You can ask Dan. Well, let's give Dan a big round of applause. You can see what it was like to work with him. It was, you know. He's very... I don't know. No, it was.
What you've done, right?
So lucky to have it in Sacramento. So lucky to have all these folks working with us. So, are there any questions from the floor that we didn't get to? We can hand you a mic. You can ask any of the speakers.
Okay, this is the Professor Severin. With the rooftop solar, isn't one of the advantages of that to increase the economic benefit for individuals, for the grassroots, to get people, you know, ordinary citizens, more invested in the transition to low carbon?
Well, I mean, you might be referring to sort of a political movement, and I guess I'm not, I don't know. But what I do know is that it's a much more expensive way to get green electricity, low carbon electricity, and it's very unlikely, it's not impossible, but it's very unlikely to be the technology that you can export to the developing world. And so I think keeping our eye on that ball is absolutely critical. And you know, we have had this discussion about environmental justice and refineries and so forth, and I think that's another case where if we actually get refineries to reduce their emissions by 30% by reducing their output, they're at 97, my numbers are 90, but whatever, go down, it will reduce local pollution. But the greenhouse gases are just going to move offshore. And so the net change in greenhouse gases is going to be zero. California will be able to pat ourselves on the back and say we've reduced our greenhouse gas footprint. Though remember that 85% is what's coming out of your tailpipe, not what's going on upstream from your tailpipe. But we will be able to claim some improvement, but it won't be a real improvement. So I think we really need to focus on, and again, you're right, I'm an economist talking, but from an economic point of view, we have to focus on technologies that the developing world is likely to adopt. And I just don't see that happening in rooftop solar. It's just so far out of the money with very little prospect because of the diseconomies of scale, of doing it at small scale, very little prospect of getting that cost down. Grid scale, so large scale solar farms, wind farms, there's offshore wind, there's some new offshore wind technologies. Right now it's incredibly expensive, but I would love to see more investment in those things that might come down in cost a lot. Rooftop solar, I think is pretty low on that list.
By the way, while we're talking, this is a good time for you to flip over that agenda and start filling out that evaluation form.
Amy?
Thanks. This is another question for Professor Bornstein. I was wondering if you could comment on the idea of a carbon tariff as a mechanism for dealing with a kind of exporting emissions, and also as a mechanism for addressing the argument, you know, that other countries like China aren't doing their share to reduce emissions.
You mean trade tariff? Yeah. I have a very quick response. California can't do it. The federal government can do it, and I think it's going to be absolutely critical at some point. On the other hand, it is going to put real pressure on trade relations. I don't think this president has either the interest or, frankly, the negotiating skill, despite what he claims, to do that in a way that is actually going to bring countries in instead of just set off a trade war. Trade adjustments for carbon. There's going to be a big fight at the WTO if we ever do this, at the World Trade Organization. But it makes a lot of sense that if we're going to do this, we're not going to then just import this stuff. But California can't do it. We, as a state, under the Constitution, we have no trade policy.
Okay. Barbara?
This is a question for Dan and Roger. So they just passed a fracking ban in Monterey County, and there's actual oil investments in Monterey County. So the oil industry, I heard from one of the guys on the steering committee, is really pushing back. And they're trying to require the the county administration to not enforce this and put another one on in a year. And they're threatening them with ruinous lawsuits. And one person on the steering committee has just said to everybody she's afraid of being sued personally and has quit. And so I promised the guy that I would come here and try to get some answers to this. You know, we could do it privately if it's inappropriate.
Well, my answer, you might not like it, but I don't think it's inappropriate. But I don't think the oil guys thought they would lose that. You know, they spent not as much as I thought they were going to spend. I mean, I forgot what the tallies were. When you saw 2 or 3 years ago, we did the same thing in Santa Barbara. We got crushed. Almost 65-35 kind of numbers. But aside from that, we've won a couple of these other local ordinances. I think the oil guys thought that they would win it, and like everything, this was another place where the people who predicted sort of got it wrong. And now the oil guys, you know, if you saw the movie The Empire Strikes Back, well, this is what's happening. So they're kind of coming in and going like, oh, that's, you know, and, you know, like, why wouldn't you have a bunch of lawyers spend a bunch of their time trying to do that? That's my guess as to what they'll do, and I think they'll, you know, if they can, try to put it on the ballot again or do something like that. Of course they will, but it'll be more important for us to be doing our, you know, organizing and education.
Thank you. I wanted to kind of bring up some of the things that Laura mentioned and ask a question of Dr. Bornstein. Laura pointed out that the actual allowances that were allowed to be purchased largely came from forests and from other kinds of the offsets, yeah. And so they did not actually reduce combustion hardly at all. And it's pretty well acknowledged that combustion is the main cause of global warming, combustion of fossil fuels. Then Laura presented the chart that showed a completely tight correlation between particulate emissions and greenhouse gases. And the fact is that in the Bay Area and maybe other places, by orders of magnitude, particulate emissions are more health damaging and lead to more premature deaths than toxic emissions do. It's the worst pollutant. And so why would we not want to directly reduce greenhouse gas emissions and then reduce the co-pollutants and get a two-for-one as a matter of policy? I know I'm in the air pollution business. I was an air quality engineer for 35 years. And I know that you can add on controls and you can change certain things and reduce the other emissions. But if you actually go after the greenhouse gas emissions from combustion, you are going to reduce the toxics and you are going to reduce PM emissions and you are going to improve public health. So when I look at the net result of the cap and trade program, it looks like as far as actually pushing the envelope and being a market, sending a market signal to actually do that hard work, it hasn't done it at all. And what it's done is made a side issue in the valley, worsening the air for people because they got credits for things they didn't do emission reductions for. And so I really want to hear you talk to that because this is really the core, I think, of why we're here today.
So I agree with Laura's graph, but what Laura's graph shows is the overall emissions, not the response to regulation. So in economics terms, it's the average or the total, not the marginal. And what you really care about, unless you're planning on shutting down or reducing the throughput of refineries, which, and when this was brought to the Air Quality Management District, was generally the view that the cap on emissions of refineries would be a cap on throughput. And yes, it would reduce emissions of CO2, it would reduce emissions of toxics, everything, because you'd just be running less through. You would not be reducing emission, CO2 emissions, because what we would do, and Roger's numbers are a little out of date, California gasoline consumption is going up, in case you had missed that. In the last year, we have started, once again, buying more SUVs and driving more and so forth, and the economy is doing well. So we would just be importing more gasoline, and the CO2 would be being produced somewhere else. Now, the toxics and the particulates would also be being produced somewhere else, which, first of all, maybe a lower density area, and second of all, maybe people were not worried about as much, but it would be still being produced. So I think that when we think about these sorts of regulations, we have to think about not overall what's the average relationship, but what would the marginal regulations actually do? And the marginal regulations in some case might do both, but in some case wouldn't. But and I'm not going to say I know that every time they're going to be uncorrelated. I'm saying let's address local pollutants directly. And I think that there are lots of ways to do that. Now, maybe politically it's not doable. Maybe these communities are so politically ineffective or unable to get reductions that this is the best you can do. But I'm going to say, tell you right now, when you actually do the math later, you're extremely likely to be disappointed. As Laura's study shows, we're already disappointed. If we actually say, well, we're going to do it at refineries, we'll be more happy with the local pollution results. But when you do the math, you're going to find out greenhouse gases haven't gone down because we just ended up importing the gasoline instead.
Okay, I think that was the last question because we told you we'd get you out of here at one, but no, there was one, thank you. Obviously an ongoing debate, an ongoing discussion. There's one important announcement that we want to make very relevant to the hours we spent together. First, I'll turn it over to Steve Nadell. We were talking about showing up and how important that is. Here's an opportunity.
Okay, let's get directly to what this debate's been about. CBE, Sunflower Alliance, 350, many groups, Sierra Club, have been working for the last 4 years to fight the transition to tar sands in the Bay Area refineries. And we're not pretending, we've never pretended that this is a greenhouse gas reduction program. This is a static, let's not get a hell of a lot worse. So we have a proposal for this numerical cap on emissions that will not shut down refineries, will not limit production from historical levels. December 7th is the next meeting of the Board of Directors of the Bay Area Air Quality Management District. That's next Wednesday at 9:45 a.m., 375 Beale Street in San Francisco. It's roughly a 10-15 minute walk from the Embarcadero Bar Station. If you're interested in talking to the Air District about this emission cap, it is on the staff agenda. Yes, the Technical Advisory Committee has been deep in opposition to us. This is a very big difference. But if you want to come out and talk in favor of that proposal, next Wednesday the 7th, You can look on the Sunflower Alliance website at sunflower-alliance.org, and the lead article on our front page will give you the historical background and links to a lot of the current documents from Roger and others. So, thank you.
Okay, thanks, because Steve just gave you one of the things that we were going to wrap up with, which is one of the actions you can take almost immediately. Also, for those of you that are involved in supporting in any way the folks at Standing Rock, the next couple of days are absolutely critical for what's going on in North Dakota, which is a representation of that map that Roger showed of all the lines kind of coming down from either North Dakota or Alberta. So there's so much going on right now that we'd love to keep in touch with all of you, and so we'll be sending some kind of, not notes from this, but follow-up, and there will be a video, there is a video, and we're going to be sharing this with folks around the state who want to kind of hear the presentations that were given today and continue this discussion with other climate and climate justice groups around the state, if it's of interest to them to see this presentation. So it's going to be a busy year, as Dan gave us a preview of. There's going to be a lot of work to do. I just see in the room, and I'll probably miss a few people, we have the League of Women Voters, we have the Sunflower Alliance, we have Citizens Climate Lobby, we have the Climate Mobilization, we have three various 350 groups, we have our partner, the Sierra Club, in co-sponsoring this workshop today. What other groups did I miss? Nicole in Oakland. Fossil Free California, Interfaith Group on Climate. Okay, so we have several Citizens Climate Lobby groups. Oh, Interfaith.
A thousand grandmothers.
A thousand grandmothers. And counting, no doubt. More grandmothers needed. Moms Out Front, Families Against Fossil Fuels. I mean, we have this amazing network in the Bay Area, and one of our challenges is to find better ways to work together to leverage our knowledge. There's incredible skills and expertise in this group, both on how to do lobbying, how to analyze bills, how to talk to academics and extract from them the information that we need, and give them input on what we think more research is needed on, actually. Whether that's health or economic or the just transition that I think is very important that Roger mentioned. So we just want to thank all of you for spending this day with us, including the Sierra Club National, which is where we are today. And please fill out your evaluation form. We would like to see whether there's a space for workshops like this where people can come together. I think probably we didn't have enough discussion amongst the people in the room, even though we had questions and answers. You guys didn't get to talk to each other. So there's only so much you can do in 3.5 hours, but I think we pushed a lot out today. So thank you for being part of that. Anything else?
Yes, I'd like to give a big shout out to the organizing committee once again. So it's a happy committee.
Legislation. Monday is the first day of the next legislative session. All the newly elected representatives, assembly, and senators will be getting inaugurated or sworn in on Monday, December 5th. State legislature. Yeah, remember that black cloud on the East Coast? We're gonna So we really would love to work with as many of you as possible to make sure the Bay Area speaks out, you know, as strongly as we can and moves all of these actions at the city level, the region level, and the state level forward. Thank you.